الحمد لله نحمده سبحانه ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله وصفوته من خلقه وحبيبه، قد بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وكشف الغمة وجاهد في سبيل دينه حتى أتاه اليقين، فاللهم اجزه عنا وعن والدينا وعن الإسلام والمسلمين خير ما جازيت به نبيا عن قومه ورسولا عن أمته. اللهم أحينا على سنته وأمتنا على ملته، واحشرنا تحت لوائه وأوردنا حوضه، واسقنا من يده الشريفة شربة هنيئة لا نظمأ بعدها أبدا. اللهم أمين. الله سبحانه وتعالى says: يا أيها الذين آمنوا إذا نودي للصلاة من يوم الجمعة فاسعوا إلى ذكر الله وذروا البيع ذلكم خير لكم إن كنتم تعلمون. فإذا قضيت الصلاة فانتشروا في الأرض وابتغوا من فضل الله واذكروا الله كثيرا لعلكم تفلحون. وإذا رأوا تجارة أو لهوا انفضوا إليها وتركوك قائما، قل ما عند الله خير من اللهو ومن التجارة والله خير الرازقين. O you who believe, when the call for the Friday prayer is called, hasten, rush into the remembrance and the reminders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And leave your business. Deliberate instruction. Leave your business. Why? ذَلِكُمْ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. This is in your best interest if you truly understand. ذَلِكُمْ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. The word خَيْر in the Quran means it is in your best interest. It's better for you. And then when the prayer is over, فَانْتَشِرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ. Go about and spread all over the earth, the land, the area. وَابْتَغُوا مِنْ فَضْلِ اللَّهِ. So here, فَاسْعَوْا إِلَى ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. Hasten into the remembrance of Allah. And following that, when the prayer is over, spread about and seek the bounties of Allah. Look at Allah. Allah is the reason you come here, and Allah's bounty is the reason you go out. So it is Allah. It is all about revolving our life around Allah. وَابْتَغُوا مِنْ فَضْلِ اللَّهِ. Seek Allah's provision and Allah's bounties. But then وَاذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا. When you go out for your business, you tend to be distracted. You forget Allah. There is a deal here and a deal there, and we tend not to remember. After we do the business, maybe next week we will ask the Sheikh, was this right or was this wrong? So Allah says, وَاذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا. And remember Allah a lot. And mention Allah a lot. Before you do something, say Bismillah. When you get something, say Alhamdulillah. But say it as a reaction to what is in your heart of love and appreciation to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let it not be a lip service. وَاذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا. Remembering Allah, as we normally do, on casual basis, doesn't seem to be paying off. Our manners do not get better. Our relationship with Allah doesn't get closer. Our interaction together does not build a good community yet. So it means whatever we do of remembrance of Allah is not paying off. So we need to understand what it is if we do will give us the full benefit of remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The full benefit of remembering Allah will come when we need Him the most. And that comes to us naturally. When I am sick, I remember Allah. When I am tight, I remember Allah. When I am depressed, I remember Allah. But when I am happy, I remember my desires. I remember my friends. I remember my family. I remember people I love. But when I am tight, I forget the orphan, the poor, the needy. I forget even my mission as a Muslim, my cause in this life. I forget. But then when I am tight, and instead of remembering things I missed, I only remember Allah. But the balance is to remember Allah all along and to make your remembrance of those who need you and those you think you need as part of your remembering of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when you are offered something, ask the question before you accept the offer. Yesterday, I had a couple who have a friend and they came to ask. They said he has an offer for a company that deals in the stock market. It manages stock markets for varieties of venture projects. One of those venture projects deals with something haram. It's wine or something like this. But the company, the managing company for which he will work, will be managing this and so many other. His job is a controller. And as a controller, he gets all financial information about all these venture projects. So they were asking, can he take this job? Or should he just stay away and look for another job? So I asked the proper questions, I think. Does he have a job? They said, no, he has been in debt, he has been this, he has been this. I said, okay. So I asked, what is his concern? They said his concern is obvious. He doesn't want to get any penny haram into his budget. I said, okay, if this is his concern, then he needs to calculate how much money the company makes, because the company pays him for what he does, and what he does serves every project. So he will serve this wine project and these other halal projects. So I said, let him calculate, and he's an auditor, he can do that, how much percentage the company makes of each project, and from that percentage, that is his share of that source of income. He can just put it aside and continue to work until he finds a job that is purely clean, halal, it doesn't have any blemish, he doesn't have to earn money and just put it away. Then they asked another question. What does he do with the money that comes through that percentage? Let's say it's 5% or 7%. What does he do with this money? And I told him, this money is not good for feeding or clothing anybody, primarily himself, of course, and his family, but it is not good to give it to someone else. That is my opinion. Some fuqaha will tell you, no, it is halal for other people, they don't know where it came from, and they can use it. But my caution is that it's better used for something different. Then they ask it, like what? I told them he can give it to an organization that spends on printing papers or toilet tissue or repairing carpet or painting, something that doesn't end up being a food or clothing for the poor and the needy. Okay? Then they ask the following question. Does this count for him as a charity? Look at the depth of the issues they are raising. These are people that I believe want to live a clean life. They want to be careful. This is dhikrillah beyond the walls of the masjid. This is dhikrillah after you leave the masjid, after your prayer. That is dhikrillah, to remember what Allah tells you in a certain situation so that you go on His path, clean, pure, and righteous, not just going with the flow. So they ask it, is this going to be counted as a charity? And looking at the collection of ayat and ahadith related to this, I ended up telling them that is not going to be the case. Because the hadith says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ طَيِّبٌ لَا يَقْبَلُ إِلَّا طَيِّبًا. Allah is pure and He does not accept charity from impure sources. It has to be pure. So I'm bringing this example just to share with you the information that transpired in the discussion, but also to point to you the importance of living an Islamic life. Living an Islamic life means I earn clean money, I eat clean food, I speak clean words, I act righteously, I pick righteous friends, I join a pure community, then and only then I am living in a Muslim environment. And every one of us can make his or her own environment. It is the people you choose, the source of earning you earn your money, it is the food you buy that should be halal in and of itself, and it is the way you speak, the way you live, and the organization of your life that should revolve around one word, Allah. This is the word that is in the center of the human life. He is the source of life. He is the source of death. He is the source of resurrection. He is the one who holds our fate in His hand. But mercifully enough, He delivers us the steering to direct our life anywhere we want. So He has the final say, but He gave us the key to protect ourselves from hellfire by following His guidance and following the light that He sent. Now let's go to the ayah, the ayat of Surah Al-Jumu'ah, one more time. فَسْعَوْا إِلَى ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. You know, when you're doing something and something more important comes, what do? You hasten, you rush to do it. You say, give me a minute, I have to take this call, it's my mom, right? Or it is my wife, my husband. But when the thing that comes is less important than what you're doing, what do? You say, do you know what? I will answer this call later on. Right? Now, in the ayah of Surah Al-Jumu'ah, when it comes to the Friday prayer, which comes once a week, Allah saying, hasten, rush. Why? Because it is something you could miss. And if you miss, you miss big. For an entire week, your heart is not easy. Your soul is not comfortable. Your spirit is dampened and maybe even depressed because you deprived it from one major function that comes only once a week. So our relationship with Allah should be upgraded to the level of responsiveness. That when He calls, we immediately value His call, the proper value, and respond accordingly. Give it the importance it deserves. Hasten, rush, go catch. You know that in the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, when you are walking to the masjid for salah, that you walk with dignity, slowly and calmly, and not rush. But when it came to the Jum'ah prayer, Allah says, فَاسْعَوْا. You know the sa'i. The sa'i is what you do between Safa and Marwa. Walking fast. Walking fast. But in the hadith about other prayers, it says walk calmly. فلتمشي بسكينة. Walk calmly and walk quietly. فما أدركتم فصلوا. Whatever you catch of the prayer, you catch. And وما فاتكم فأتموا. Whatever you miss one rak'ah, then فأتموا, make it up. You complete what you miss of the prayer. But on the Friday prayer, the ayah means do not ever miss anything. Don't miss the khutbah. Don't miss even the beginning of the khutbah. And that's why the reward in the other hadith is consistent and relevant to how early one comes to the prayer. Because if you only come after the imam, you miss the biggest portion of your reward. And then what does this teach us? It teaches us that part of being a Muslim is to be very keen to do the right thing. أن تكون حريصا على ما ينفعك. As it is told in the hadith, احرص على ما ينفعك. If you are حريص, if you are keen, if you want to protect your interest and you have an appointment with the doctor, you don't want him to cancel on you, you rush. You don't go 1 hour late or half an hour late and say, I'm sorry. He will tell you also, I'm also sorry. I took somebody else. So we have to be treating Allah both with the respect and the appreciation of whom we are dealing with. It's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then in the sunnah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says that on Friday, likewise on Eid day, which means in jama'ah, gathering, it is in the sunnah that you take a shower if you can. And I believe living in this country where water is readily and easily available, there is no excuse for anyone to come without showering, at least in the morning before you go to your work. Maybe you come from work, that's okay. But on a Friday, you need to shower, you need to freshen up so that when you come, you don't smell bad, your neighbor is not terrified or bothered by your smell. And also to put perfume or fragrance, something that gives a good smell, so that you are a point of attraction, not distraction, to those around you. And then when we come, the sunnah says, you sit in the most and the closest point to the imam. If you come first, sit closest, because the ajr goes to those who come first. So there is no point that we come first and sit all the way in the back as if we are hiding from something. The angels go from front to back. Likewise, the reward. So we have to be tracing and learning the sunnah. And when you come, the first thing you do before you sit down is to pray a couple of rak'ah. What does this prayer signify? When you go to somebody's house, what do you say? Say, Assalamu alaikum. When you come to Allah's house, these two rak'ah of tahiyya are the greeting of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To greet the house of Allah by prayer, couple of rak'ah. What do these rak'ah do? They prepare you to recognize the majesty of Allah and the majesty of His place. So that when we are in the masjid, whether we are praying, or we are waiting for prayer, or we finished prayer, this place has to always have decorum, quiet and calm. It shouldn't turn into a market. One of the things that are prohibited in the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ is when somebody comes and says, I lost my shoes. Did anyone see my shoes? Seeking what you lose is not in the masjid in this way. You can look for it, you can ask somebody to help you look for it, but you don't announce in the masjid as if this were a park or a street. Also, it is prohibited to sell and buy inside the masjid. Why? Because We don't want to turn it into a marketplace. Everybody is bringing something and they want to promote it and market it. This is not befitting in the masjid. It's a house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You come to the house of Allah, what is your purpose? Your purpose is for your sins to be forgiven, your spirit to be charged, your soul to be guided, and your heart to be corrected, so that you feel the right way to make the right choices. So this is one of the purposes of salah. And as we do the salah, which we do it, of course, in jama'ah, there are lots of lessons for us as a community. When you stand behind the imam, where do you direct your face? To the Qibla, Mecca, right? So, as if the jama'ah prayer, the congregational prayer, is telling us, you as a community, you as an ummah, you only have one direction to look for, and just one to worship, that is Allah. And one prophet to follow, that is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because if you follow him, you follow the best of all prophets. Meaning the best of practice, the best of traditions, the best of sunnah, the best of character, everything. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Of course, all of them are the best. But Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, both in the revelation he received from Allah, and the guidance and the wisdom Allah taught him, he captured all what is good in any prophet's revelation or law or anything. So if you follow him, you have followed everybody else. And also, when we stand united in our direction, it is also to mean that we should be united in our heart. Our hearts should not be looking right and left. We are all looking up to Allah to forgive us. We are looking up to Him so that we only worship Him. Then in the salah, before we say Allahu Akbar, we line up. And in the sunnah, you should make a straight line. Similar to what Allah says in the battlefield, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الَّذِينَ يُقَاتِلُونَ فِي سَبِيلِهِ صَفًّا كَأَنَّهُمْ بُنْيَانٌ مَرْصُوصٌ. So you should touch your neighbor. Leave no gaps for shaitan or anything else. You should be like a block, building block next to each other. And this should remove all the barriers, the class barriers, the money barriers, the status barriers, the power barriers. We are all one. It doesn't matter whom you're sitting next to. We are all equal when we stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this should bring our hearts closer to each other. Then to teach us also to be organizing and organized and good followers, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, إِنَّمَا جُعِلَ الْإِمَامُ لِيُؤْتَمَّ بِهِ. The imam is meant to be followed. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا لِيُطَاعَ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. Your following of the imam is obedience to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in his sunnah. But what else does it teach us? That we move as one body. فَإِذَا كَبَّرَ فَكَبِّرُوا. When the imam finishes takbir, you enter into takbir. وَإِذَا رَكَعَ فَارْكَعُوا. When he makes ruku'ah, then you make ruku'ah. You don't rush to catch up with him, and you don't rush to race with him. You're not equal with the imam. Not as a person, but as a follower, as a ma'moom. The sunnah is to follow the imam, not to race with the imam. Some brothers, they hear the imam say Allah, before he says Akbar, they already made ruku' or sujood. That is not correct. The correct way is to let the imam finish the motion, and after he settles, you make your move. After he says Allahu Akbar, and the ra came out, then you start moving. Don't race with him. فَإِذَا سَجَدَ فَاسْجُدُوا فَإِذَا سَلَّمَ فَسَلِّمُوا. When he is done and he makes salam, then you can make salam. Then the ayah goes and says,
فإذا قضيت الصلاة فانتشروا في الأرض. When the salah is finished, go about wherever you want to go and roam the earth, spread out and seek the bounties of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Quran has guidance in this issue. The Quran says, كُلُوا مِمَّا فِي الْأَرْضِ حَلَالًا طَيِّبًا. حَلَالًا refers to the source, the money, how you earn it. And طَيِّبًا refers to the substance that you buy, the substance that you sell and buy and consume. It has to be طَيِّبًا. So when we go out, we don't leave Allah here, because Allah doesn't live in a place. This is His house, but this is not His limited space that we should leave Him, as seculars would want us to do. Allah, وَهُوَ مَعَكُمْ أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُمْ. Allah is with you wherever you are. That sense of bringing Allah to bear on both our feeling and our decisions, even when we are away of the masjid, is what makes the Muslim stands out to be a unique person. So I am a cab driver, and I go about to earn my good living, and I take customers from one place to another place, and sometimes people forget stuff in my car. So after each passenger, I should examine and make sure that the passenger picked everything. So it should be a routine for me, sir, did you pick everything you have? And if he ends up forgetting something because he thought he got everything, if I don't check the car after he leaves, I may think it is the previous passenger or the following passengers. Okay? So when I exercise honesty and diligence, I am practicing my Islam. Some people call it to be a professional driver. I call it to be a good Muslim, to be a practicing Muslim. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ speaks of a merchant, a businessman. And he says, التَّاجِرُ الْأَمِينَ الصَّدُوقَ مَعَ النَّبِيِّينَ وَالصِّدِّيقِينَ وَالشُّهَدَاءَ وَالصَّالِحِينَ. An honest businessman will be gathered with the prophets, with the martyrs, with the righteous people on the day of judgment. What a good company. It's the greatest company. So when we exercise honesty, when we exercise diligence in our business, when we are truthful, when we describe what we sell to our customers, we are practicing Islam. It is like praying. You think you are rewarded when you pray. You also are rewarded when you conduct your business as a Muslim. You are rewarded. Even when you walk in the street, the Prophet ﷺ says, وَإِمَاطَةُ الْأَذَى عَنِ الطَّرِيقِ صَدَقَةً. When you remove a hurdle, some wood or iron or even a small stone that you see in the middle of the street, and you see that it is safe enough to remove it, removing it protects a life. It can protect somebody's life. So the Prophet ﷺ says, removing it is a charity, it's a sadaqah. What is sadaqah? Sadaqah is a sign of your sidq. It's a proof and evidence of your truthfulness. So the Prophet ﷺ says, As-salatu nur. Prayer is a light. وَالصَّدَقَةُ burhan, and charity is evidence. It's a proof. So the prayer should be a light, and the light, we use it to lighten our life where it is not lit by anything else. And there is nothing to lit our life better than prayer. There is nothing to illuminate our judgment better than our prayer, our reading of the Quran, our standing and prostration before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we should capture all the benefits of coming to the masjid and turn it into a light into our life. And also so that we don't forget, the ayah says, وَذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا. Don't let Allah be a casual mention in your life. Whenever you remember Him, you say something. And we think that when we say this, then I remember Allah. But remembering Allah has, what is most important is the practice of what He taught you. Give you an example to illustrate and not to compare, of course. You as parents, when you tell your child, do this or don't do that, and the child goes out and he comes at the end of the day and he tells you, Daddy, you know what? I did what you told me not to do. What do you ask him? Why did you do it? He says, I forgot. Meaning, if he remembers you, most probably he would not do it. If he remembers his love and respect for you and your word and your guidance, he would not do it. If he appreciates your guidance, he wouldn't violate it. So similarly, not to be exactly similar, when we remember Allah, it should be a remembrance of what He expects of us. Then prayer becomes a light. As-salatu nur. It lights our life so that we are guided. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala lit our life and our hearts with the Quran and with our prayer. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وبعد. As we mentioned before, the most important cleansing process that we have in Islam to get rid of corruption, tyranny, deviation, disobedience, all of the human bad manners is what is called أمرٌ بالمعروف ونهيٌ عن المنكر. Parallel to this, there is a process, another process that is called Shura. And Shura comes from Shawara, not the English shower, but Shawara is used for water when it runs in a stream and it keeps picking the whatever is pollutant, pushes it aside, and the clean water goes in the middle of the stream. Okay? So Shura as a process, we pick and throw on the table all the opinions, and in the process, we put aside all the bad ideas and the bad opinions and pick the best to lead us forward and move us forward. So this is a process of cleansing opinions. But cleansing action has to come in another process. It's called Amr bil Ma'ruf and nahi an munkar, to enjoin and encourage doing the good and to forbid and denounce doing evil or bad. Unfortunately, we are not good business people when it comes to being a Muslim. While we understand that Islam is a business, we explained this before, tijara, it's a business between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but we don't do good business with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He offers us all opportunities, all generosity. He counts everything good we do, and He wipes our bad deeds with good deeds, and He advances His generosity over all of our evil, and still we are not giving Allah the priority and the importance and the appreciation He deserves, at least for His generosity, at least for His forgiveness. This is a habit that we have to break with. We have to break away with bad habits. Otherwise, if we continue to live from Friday to Friday, hearing khutbah, hearing hadith, saying this is good, this is better, this is excellent, but then we do nothing of what we hear, we're not changing, we're not cleansing, we're not purifying our life. So the shura purifies our ideas, collective ideas, that is. And Amr bil Ma'ruf and Nahi al-Munkar should cleanse us as a society, as a community. that we stop anybody doing anything wrong, and we push forward, support, and encourage anyone doing something good. This is the position of the Muslim. This is your central mission as a Muslim after the traditional worshiping of Allah, is to expand that worship to include the rest of your life and to pick up your role as a shura member in the society by giving your opinion, sharing your ideas, and supporting good ones, and by guiding yourself and others to enjoin the good and forbid the evil. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us stand for what is good and help us stand against what is evil. Tomorrow we have two good opportunities coming at us. One is a stand against evil, that is the military coup in Egypt. The Egyptian Americans for Democracy and Human Rights are staging a large demonstration in front of the United Nations to object to the entering and the delivering of the speech on behalf of Egypt by a minister of foreign affairs who is part of a coup government. Okay? And the bus will leave here at 3:30 in the morning, and we hope that those who signed up will come and bring even their friends if they can. But we need to know the number. Up until now, one bus is full. So if there is anybody more interested to come, and I hope that there are more, we will be more than happy to get the Egyptian Americans will be more than happy to get another bus or van to help in the process. Okay? We also have another opportunity for those who are not going to New York to attend the CARE annual fundraising banquet. You know that CARE has been the front organization that defends Muslim rights in the United States. And it is also an organization that has dealt with media issue, Islamophobia issue, and other issues on behalf of our community. They deserve and they need our support. They deserve and they need our support. They are issuing reports after reports about the Islamophobia, the attack on Muslims, the statistics of what is going on with Muslim trials, Muslim accusations. They are working both with the government and with other civil rights organizations to defend our rights and to defend our existence, indeed, as Muslims. They deserve that we defend their finance, and at least if you cannot volunteer with them, at least give them the money to hire staff. They hired a full staff of lawyers to pick up cases to defend Muslims on behalf of anybody. You get fired illegally, they provide you with assistance. You get attacked illegally, you get harassed, you get any problem because you are a Muslim, you go to CARE and they will provide you the support you need, whatever they have and whatever they can. So please support them. They are selling their tickets outside as you exit in the lobby, and the tickets are, I believe, $65 or so. So please buy as many tickets as you can. اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا وثبت أقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. اللهم اهدنا في من هديت وعافنا في من عافيت وتولنا في من توليت وقنا واصرف عنا شر ما قضيت. اللهم اقسم لنا من خشيتك ما تحول به بيننا وبين معصيتك، ومن طاعتك ما تبلغنا به جنتك، ومن اليقين ما تهون به علينا مصائب الدنيا. ومتعنا اللهم بأسماعنا وأبصارنا وقوتنا ما أحييتنا، واجعله الوارث منا، واجعل ثأرنا على من ظلمنا، ولا تجعل مصيبتنا في ديننا. اللهم طهر قلوبنا وطهر نياتنا وأخلص أعمالنا وأحسن خاتمتنا وأحسن عاقبتنا في الأمور كلها، وأجرنا من خزي الدنيا ومن عذاب الآخرة. اللهم لا تجعل للشيطان على بيوتنا سبيلا، ولا تجعل للشيطان على قلوبنا سبيلا، ولا تجعل للشيطان على ذرياتنا سبيلا. اللهم أخرج الشيطان من بين المسلمين، اللهم ألف بين قلوبنا، اللهم اجمع صفنا ووحد كلمتنا وأحسن خلاصنا وأحسن ختامنا، واحشرنا مع النبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين وحسن أولئك رفيقا. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم، فستذكرون ما أقول لكم، وأفوض أمري إلى الله، إن الله بصير بالعباد. وأقم الصلاة.